maybe just to comment, I really listened to the previous discussion. It's the bane of my life, for my professional life, for the past 15, 17 years. For me, just two reflections is that I call it internet banking fraud. The rest of the world, the banks were better at their advertising, call it SIM swap fraud. The interesting thing here is that if you do a SIM swap, you can't get the internet banking PIN and password. That is only known to the bank and to the customer. So the fraudster first obtained the internet banking PIN and password. There's syndicates that we call farming. They farm, they steal that. And then they sell it to the people that commit the internet banking fraud, and they outsource the SIM swaps to a syndicate that's specializing in doing the SIM swaps, and then the poor customer in the end loses. So please call it internet banking slash SIM swap fraud. I have implemented many things to make SIM swaps more difficult. You'll see in my speech when I talk about the fraud, it's very much based on identity theft, what's there. But at the end, we lose about our customer base. We do about 200,000 SIM swaps a month for people's phones who were stolen. And we need to have that balance between security and easiness to the person that's traumatized to get them back their communication. So I've said to the banks, and we've had some robust discussion, and jokingly, please go back to spot, because that is today's transaction, today's value, then you will have no internet banking fraud, tongue in cheek. But over the years, I have had about 10 instances of people that actually stole the SIM card because they wanted the SIM card. They didn't want to connect internet banking fraud. And about 8 of the 10 were bad divorce cases where it was just pure out of pure spite. When I look at there's some people my age or just younger than me, I'm a big supporter of biometric recognition. So I did my thesis in 1988 on voice recognition. Unfortunately, due to my accent, even today, voice recognition systems, I can't speak to Google or whatever, Alexa, or they just say, please repeat, I don't understand the question. So we still have time to go on that. But maybe on my topic for today is the culture change, and this is generic, it takes time. And you really need the buy-in from the top. And in the end, it is the best long-term solution. But to explain about the fraud journey that I've been on for the past 8 years is some of the strange things of our industry in South Africa and worldwide is telcos don't have, we call the jokingly, people refer to it. If you talk about customers, yes, we have SIM cards. We don't know which belly button customer, human flesh, does that SIM card belong to. Our business model is based on SIM cards, and market share is the main driver. In competing in South Africa, the time between the buy decision and when you actually put the handset and the SIM card in the customer's hand is truly a deciding factor. And from a fraud perspective, specifically when we went into online call centers and those, I'm being asked, but why do we have so much fraud? Surely Amazon's, Take a Lot, those airlines, they are in the online business. Why do they don't have similar amounts of fraud? Very easy answer. They have payment certainty before they ship the product. Telcos give you that nice, what's it, iPhone 14 Pro Max Black, 40,000 rand, before we verified that we can do a debit order from your bank account. Because if Vodacom don't give it to that customer immediately, he walks next door and going to get it from MTN, Cell C or Telkom. So that's part of my frustration and responsibility for fraud. Also, the concept of subsidized handsets is, yes, we're beginning to, if people want a real expensive one, ask them to pay in, but in the end, in South Africa, you don't say, I want to wait for my 24 months to be over so I go on a cheaper package. People say, I can't wait so that I can choose a new phone. People have no idea what the value of handsets are. And this is where the fraud comes in. Criminals want the handsets to export it into Africa and the rest of the world. Our identity register, where we blacklist phones, are shared with Europe and America. It's not shared with Mozambique and Tanzania and Zimbabwe. So stolen phones walk across the border or sold across the border or exchanged as payment for drugs across the border and being sold there. So there's a big industry in defrauding the telcos to get that hands on a handset. The SIM card is thrown away, no calls are being made. And then on the subject of identity theft is that it's easy in South Africa to falsify a password. As we said, we're looking at the ID, person can't see where there's the right person. So my best example was about 14 years back, you can think of... We blacklisted for non-payment the editor of the U and H Groot magazine. So she was very, very unhappy. And in the end, I faced one of her journalists. And then I said, bring with a copy of her pay slip and ID book. And then I gave him the most beautiful forged pay slip, ID, Joburg municipality account, and I think it was a Standard Bank bank account where the salary were in the bank account, the payment for the municipal bank account was in there, and I said to him, and in the end we gave the guy that walked out with this, or the lady that walked out with this, because it was a lady, the photo, is only the ID were actually correct on all these documents, two iPhones. So we've lost so much money. Yes, your editor had inconvenience in she couldn't buy a house, but we've removed her from blacklisting at the credit bureau. And then in the end, he wrote a very nice article about identity theft and the problems that we face instead of slamming Vodacom. So about 8 years ago, this use case happened where we couldn't understand why there was what one called such a high level of never pay. We lost about 20 to 30 million rand a month on people that took out handsets and never paid their first installment. Remember where I go back is to say, if you pass our credit vetting processes, we give you a handset. And the business model was also such that business are interested in new connections, hence going back to new SIM cards and to do upgrades so that we can keep the customer. Not interested in having preventing fraud. IT wanted a good user experience, and they didn't want to change systems and update systems. And the fraud division that reported to me was deemed to be responsible to detect and prevent fraud. And because of this high level of what we call never pay, the CEO called, he was who was also then acting MD at a time called for South Africa, called me in and say, you have a team of three people that you can take, and you can employ another six, and we call them process solutions and implementation. Find and stop this happening. So the brief were, find where we're bleeding, get the systems changed, and put an interim workarounds to stop us from bleeding. So I got my people 2 days later, and we brainstormed, and we said, where do we start? And then the one analyst said, let's start. It's about phones, we think so. So he understood. He was a business analyst for the handset delivery area, how it was shipped. And then he went in, locked, see where there was address changes of the delivery address. And now what was the high-value phones, let's say iPhones, and it would now be delivered to Hillbrow. And then he called the people and put a verbal block and say, you may not ship this phones tomorrow. And all hell break loose because I was now stopping handsets and I was stopping people achieving their objectives and targets and not getting their bonuses. And then I also from this got customer care to say, I can't call because my people are policemen and IT specialists. We can't talk to customers. So please give me four or five people that can call customers and ask, did they do this upgrade? And I got my people and they called. And 100% of those that we stopped in the first week, the customer confirmed were fraudulent. It was not them that did the upgrade. And then just pure manual process, we stopped about 1 million rand in that month. But over time, and I'll get to my last slide, where we automated this, then we got RPAs to make it better, and currently it's an AI solution. At that time, I said, how do I change that this is a shared responsibility? Because business was unhappy about the block connections, IT was unhappy about I wanted to make them do system changes, and my fourth division was extremely happy because now they could concentrate on trying to find the criminals. And I got everybody to get them in a monthly steer co. And there was heated debate at the beginning. But we then were able to quantify what the subscription fraud were, instead of it ending up in bad debt. And then we could start working together to prevent fraud. I hated this monthly meeting. Now it's my most pleasant one. Monthly meeting exists 8 years later. So maybe the first culture change is that because we quantified how much money were lost, business changed their mind. It took a few years to say that prevention is better than detection. And I just got that accidental that from the internet, and it's very strange that it's so near to our reality, is that for never pay, we only truly identify it as potential bad debt fraud after 90 days or after 3 months. So the 99 days on average, that's when we know this was a fraudulent transaction. We didn't concentrate on stopping it. And there's now about, I would say, 70% acceptance that profitable subscribers are better, or less profitable subscribers are better than more fraudulent subscribers. So that connection rate, about a percentage of new connections or percentage of upgrades, is being focused. Then the 20 million that I've talked about is reduced by about 75%. If you talk to people in the supermarket industry, they talk about pilferage or shrinkage, and they have a percentage of their sales that are shrinkage. Yes, I can make it impossible for fraud to happen, but then we will also not have new connections and lose our market share. So there is a period of what we are happy to live with in where people still take us in from a never pay solution. The second culture change that I had to work on was to get IT to give me priority to fix the loopholes. So we started off with what we call a PI session. Every quarter we sat together, the Exco and their direct reports fight for IT resources to say what will we fix, where we will fix it. And I'm glad to hear George this morning about he's saying he stayed true to his values, because he chaired one of those, and that was sort of one of the starts. I had, we call it sticky-free yellow things on the board to say, I need to fix this system in consumer business, this system in enterprise business, and this system in customer care. I don't know why I must motivate for it. It should actually be the director for each of those. And for this one, if we fix this, we will save 20 million for the year, because I've identified we've already lost 10 million. This one 4, this one 5, because people didn't want to give me the scarce resources to fix the system. And George looked at it and he said, you know, Johan, those three things together, you're asking for about 400,000 rand's worth of development effort, and you will save us all and our bonuses about 50 million rand. So I can't argue about this new system that I think my customers want and my people want us to develop, where we will hope we will make a few million rands of revenue from this next year. You can have my 40 hours for this system. And that changed the first culture, because suddenly he was the consumer business unit. He gave in for his one. Then the customer care and the business unit also gave me their hours, and they cancelled some of their products and priorities. Then that slowly changed, but about 3-4 years into the process, I needed a way to get things fixed much quicker. So I then decided to interpret the mandate I was given to say, I can give an instruction for something to be fixed as quick as possible. So we introduced the concept called the P0, and again, where this is stop any development on any systems, fix this first. And for business, it meant we've identified these loopholes, is you will now reallocate resources, hire temps or whatever, to do some of the control checks manually. So again, there was a relatively big fight about this, because they needed to spend money or there were systems left. But then the P0 suddenly started to happen. There was real issues identified. There were visibility. And then it now came to about a year back what I call full acceptance. There was no pushback to the P0s, where I said I need to have system and manual changes to processes, because the one thing that my team could do properly, being business analysts, was to quantify how much was lost. So I talked about where we started the analyst to say which address changes ended up in Hilbra. So we've now truly have added that, where we use AI, where we take from so many sources. I think there's about 36 feeds into this to identify possible fraudulent new subscriptions and upgrades, and specifically in the telesales environment. Because again, there you authenticate the person without seeing him, you get the information over the phone, you put it in the system, and the system says it's credit worthy. And there's certain items or things that say this is a flag, and then There's an automated block, so no need to find. There's a routing to a call center. And at one stage, due to budget cuts and whatever, the call center, those few people that I had for confirmations were left, and then I had to go back and beg for money, and then I quantified it, and then I got the FD involved, and then he at the time said, but I will allocate budget, customer care, you will employ these people. Currently, I think last month's stats was, it cost about R1 million a call center, and we stopped about R10 million worth of handsets that would have been gone out fraudulent, for which we would have not paid no payment. And the actual customer, whether it's a new person or they confirmed that they didn't do that upgrade. And maybe my last slide, why I now say there's many more things that we'll do, but for this specific journey on subscription fraud, the culture has changed. When we declare P0, we ask what's the impact, what's the effort of involvement, what's give us an idea of time, is it possible, do it not? And it's now surprising, it now goes to IT, and then the feedback the next day was, Johan, no need to raise a P0, we put in the fix last night. Absolutely wonderful from my perspective. Yes, the rest of the business hate me for this. And I can't think about any of the salespeople having serious objections to blocking sales. They still say, I'm the chief product prevention officer, but they now accept that we are blocking real fraudulent sales. And this one is most probably for me the best example where the culture has changed. So our current MD, when he became back from Tanzania, he set up in the beginning a weekly exco on a Tuesday, and then my fraud meetings were also set up, and then his business manager phoned me and said, Johan, there's four of the directors that say, we can't attend EXCO. Can we please have a 90-minute break? We must attend the fraud steerco. Can you not move it? I said, no, there's about 40 other people. I set it up long ago. She said, okay, I'll put in a break in the EXCO agenda. So EXCO broke so that those four directors could attend my fraud steerco. So for me, that was most probably where I say, I have arrived. Like that. Really the size. And as part of this discussion and getting people to brainstorm how do we fix what's it there, there's definitely now more focus on preventing fraud across all the silos that exist within Vodacom. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, he has arrived. Another round of applause for Johan.